Hi guys, welcome to lecture number 2 of electric charges and fields. In the previous lecture, we have introduced you to electricity, charge and its properties. In this lecture, we will be discussing about Coulomb's law, force between multiple charges and some problems based on these topics. So, moving on to the first part, Coulomb's law. Before going to Coulomb's law, you should know about point charges. See, consider these two charges. When the size of these charge bodies are very small as compared to the distance between them, they can be considered as point charges. Okay, as you now know about point charges, we can move to Coulomb's law. So, what does Coulomb's law state? Coulomb's law states that force between two point charges vary inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. So, F directly proportional to 1 by R square, where R is the distance between two point charges. And directly proportional to the product of the magnitude of two charges. Therefore, F is also directly proportional to product of magnitude of two charges, which are Q1 and Q2. So, combining equation 1 and 2, we get F directly proportional to magnitude of Q1 into magnitude of Q2 by R square. Removing the proportionality, it gives us F equal to K into Q1, Q2 by R square, where K is the constant of proportionality. So, this is Coulomb's law. See, one doubt you may arise is that whether magnitude of Q1 into magnitude of Q2 equal to magnitude of Q1, Q2. See guys, here Q1 and Q2 can take either positive or negative values only. Therefore, this equation is valid in this particular context. For example, see this. Suppose Q1 equal to minus 3, Q2 equal to 2, then magnitude of Q1 into magnitude of Q2 will give us 6. Also, magnitude of Q1 into Q2 will also give us magnitude of minus 6 equal to 6. See, thus throughout this lecture, I may interchangeably write magnitude of Q1 into magnitude of Q2 as magnitude of Q1, Q2. We have found the equation of Coulomb's law as F equal to K into magnitude of Q1, Q2 by R square. But we haven't discussed about the value of K. In SI units, K is given as 9 into 10 raised to 9 Newton. This can also be written as 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Newton, where epsilon 0 is the permittivity of free space whose value is given by 8.854 into 10 raised to minus 12 Newton meter raised to minus 2 Coulomb square. Thus, Coulomb law equation become F equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 into Q1 Q2 by R square. See, this equation is valid for two charges in free space only. Suppose the point charges are present in a medium whose relative permittivity is given by epsilon R, then equation modifies to F equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 into epsilon R into Q1 Q2 by R square. This is the final equation for Coulomb's law. So study this guys. I will be getting a lot of questions based on this equation. Now consider two point charges whose values are Q1 equal to 1 Coulomb equal to Q2 and the distance between them R equal to 1 meter. Putting these values in the above equation, we get F equal to 9 to 10 raised to 9 Newton. So from this, we can define 1 Coulomb of charge. Therefore, 1 Coulomb is a charge when placed at a distance of 1 meter from another charge of same magnitude in vacuum experiences an electric force of repulsion of the magnitude of 9 to 10 raised to 9 Newton. So, let's note that if you don't write in vacuum in the expression, then the entire expression becomes wrong and will not be awarded any marks. And study this equation really well as it will be asked for one mark in exams. Okay guys, till now we have talked only about the magnitude of force. But we know that force is a vector. So it has both magnitude and direction. So we will be talking about the vector representation of Coulomb's law in the next topic. Let O represent the origin. So R1 is the position vector of Q1 from origin and R2 is the position vector of Q2 from origin. Before going on to the vector form of Coulomb's law, there are some basic terminologies you should know. that is F12 represents the force on Q1 due to Q2, and similarly F21 represents the force on Q2 due to Q1. Similarly, the vector leading from Q1 to Q2 is given by R21, which is nothing but R2 minus R1, where R2 and R1 are in vector form. And R12 is the vector leading from Q2 to Q1 and is given by R12, which is nothing but vector R1 minus vector R2. Now, since you are familiar with the representation F12, F21, R21 and R12, we will discuss about unit vectors. Unit vectors are used to define the direction of a vector. Suppose let A be a vector, then the direction of A is given by unit vector, which is denoted by A cap is equal to vector A by magnitude of A. Here, unit vectors are used to define the direction from Q1 to Q2 and similarly Q2 to Q1. The direction of Q1 to Q2 is given by R21 cap, which is vector R21 divided by magnitude of vector R21. Similarly, we get R12 cap is equal to vector R12 by magnitude of vector R12. Note that vector R12 is nothing but negative of vector R21, and also magnitude of R12 is equal to magnitude of R21. Therefore, we can write this equation as minus R21 cap by magnitude of R21, which is equal to minus R21 cap. Therefore, note that R12 cap is equal to minus of R21 cap. Guys, note that in textbook, it is given as R21 cap is equal to R12 cap. This is wrong. Don't study this. You will lose marks. This is the correct one. Okay. Therefore, based on the above terminologies we studied, Coulomb's law force between two charges Q1 and Q2 located at R1 and R2 can be written as F12 is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 into magnitude of Q1, Q2 by R12 square into R12 cap, where this R12 is the magnitude of vector R12 and the direction of F12 is given by the unit vector R12 cap. Therefore, this is the Coulomb's law in vector form. Study this well. This will be a fundamental equation we will be using in many more chapters to come. Now, to summarize the topics, we have a few points. When Q1 and Q2 are like charges, as in this case, the direction of F21 is along R21 cap. And similarly, for unlike charges, we know the forces are attractive. Therefore, direction of F21 is along this direction, which is opposite to R21 cap, that is given by minus R21 cap, which is equal to R12 cap. So what do we mean by this point? This means that we do not have to write separate equation for F21 when the charges are like or unlike, but equation F21 equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 into Q1 Q2 by R21 square into R21 cap will take care of both the situation alike. The second point states that F12, which is the force on 1 due to 2, is simply equal to negative of F21, which is the force on 2 due to 1. Okay, with that, we have completed this topic and we will be moving to the next topic, which is the forces between multiple charges. Okay, till now, we have learned about forces between two charges only. In this topic, we will be discussing what to do when there are multiple charges present. While calculating the forces between multiple charges, the following points are to be considered. The first point is, force on any charge due to a number of other charges is the vector sum of all forces on that charge due to other charges taken one at a time. So what does this mean? Suppose we need to find the force on charge Q1 due to other charges Q2 and Q3. Poisson Q1 due to Q2 is given by F12, where F12 is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q1 Q2 by R12 square into R12 cap. Similarly, Poisson Q1 due to Q3 is given by F13, which is F13 equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q1 Q3 by R13 square into R13 cap. Then the net force F1 is given by parallelogram law, this vector sum of F13 and F12. Writing this mathematically, F1 equal to F12 plus F13 equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q1 Q2 by R12 square into R12 cap plus 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q1 Q3 by R13 square into R13 cap. Similarly, the equation for F1 can be generalized. Suppose there are n charges, then F1, which is the force on Q1 due to other charges, is given by F12 plus F13 plus etc. plus F19, which is 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q1 Q2 by R12 square into R12 cap plus Q1 Q3 by R13 square into R13 cap plus etc. plus Q1 Qn by R1n square into R1n cap, which is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 sigma I equal to 2 to n Q1 Qy by R1i square into R1i cap. So this is final equation, which is the force on a charge due to multiple charges. Now the second point, which is individual forces are unaffected by other charges. Let us understand this by a simple example. Suppose the force on Q1 due to Q3 is given by F13, and by this point the force F13 is not affected by other charges present. Here, for example, Q2 does not affect this force F13. This point is not so important, but just know about that, that's all. Now, you can look into some questions based on what you have studied today.